Aloha, welcome to Global Connections. I'm your host, Grace Cheng, and I'm joined here today by Dr. Seung-Kyun Ko of Hawaii Pacific University. He's a professor of international relations and political science, and we'll be talking about the Korean War and its significance today. So welcome to the program, Dr. Ko.
Thank you.
Nice to have you here.
Okay, thanks.
Great, great. And you have been teaching at Hawaii Pacific University on East Asian international relations, Asian politics, numerous different courses. So you've been here for a while and doing this for a bit. So could you please give us a little background on your history, your work in this field, where you came from?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Well, as you said, I'm a professor of international relations and political science at HPU now. I've been teaching almost like half century, 50 years, mm-hmm. since 1963.
Oh, wow.
Uh-huh. And I've worked for State Department, also Ministry of Foreign Affairs, and then taught in various universities in the mainland and East Asia. And as you said, my field of specialty is international relations, focusing on East Asia. I was born in Seoul, Korea, then raised there, then came to the United States for study. Mm-hmm. So after receiving my doctorate from University of Pennsylvania, I went back to Korea and worked for Ministry of Foreign Affairs and taught at the Seoul National University at the graduate school level. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Then I came back to the United States and 1972, then since that time I've been teaching at HPU until
okay.
now.
Okay, and did you say you also worked at the State Department?
Yes.
Oh, okay. When was that, in what capacity?
That was from 1972, then from 1972 to 2003, as I was a linguist.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay. Well, that's an interesting time, huh?
Yes.
The 70s when
right.
a lot of change going on in East Asia. The U.S. starts to open up with China.
Right.
And a lot of, so there must have been a big impact in East Asian international
right.
relations.
Right, that's right.
And you got to see that, a little bit insight into that while you were working there?
Well, it was really very interesting job. Because my job was essentially to introduce United States to visiting VIPs mm-hmm. from Korea and sometimes other countries too. Then basically, you know, to take this VIP visitor to various parts, you know, various parts of the United States, visit Congress, mm-hmm. visit Supreme mm-hmm. Court, then Defense Department, State Department, whatever. Then we travel around. all over United States, go to New York, Boston, and go to Harvard,
okay.
Yale,
uh-huh.
Princeton, have a seminar with the professor specializing the area which VIP is interested in.
Okay.
Then we
uh-huh.
go to Chicago, then go to Stanford in California. So actually I travel around mm-hmm. all of the United States almost like over 30 times.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And that was really great experience I've had in my life.
Yeah, yeah. And you have contact with all the specialists in the
yes.
different universities,
right.
the major
right.
departments of study there.
Right.
Oh, that's a great introduction and interesting, must have interesting conversations
right.
and insights from
right.
that.
Right.
Yeah, yeah. And so, I mean, that's a really fascinating background. So you were, you know, you were born when the Korean War had unfolded and going on, and then you were teaching throughout, like, most of the Cold War period. So I know you're, so currently your project is you're working on a book on the Korean War,
yes.
and that is, you know, history, but also talking about the significance of it today, and also incorporating some of your background
mm-hmm.
or your own experience of the
mm-hmm.
war. So let's talk a bit first about the Korean War itself, I mean, and this book project that you're working on.
Very good. I've been working on this book project for some time, and very likely will be published sometime coming June.
Mm-hmm. Great.
So almost halfway.
Uh-huh.
And I wrote this book because there are so many books written on the Korean War. I think it's over 20 books
mm-hmm.
and various authors, by various authors and all that. But most books written by American authors, so they touch on American perspective,
right.
American interpretation
uh-huh.
of Korean War.
Mm-hmm.
There are very few books written by Koreans themselves, although Koreans were the objects of the Korean War.
Mm-hmm.
They were the, you know, experiencing all this Korean War going on and everything. for whatever reason, maybe not too many books written by Korean authors. Mm-hmm. So I felt that I was compelled to write something with Korean, as a Korean mm-hmm. American, and to give Korean perspective.
Mm-hmm. Makes sense. Uh-huh.
So I studied on this book, and then it's basically survey to Korean War. And after this, I plan to write another book, which will be Seungmanri and Korean War. That will be definitive study. Mm-hmm. But anyway, the book which I'm writing include the beginning of the Korean War to the end of Korean War. So 3 years span of Korean War. Mm-hmm. So Korean War started with North Korean invasion of South Korea.
And yes.
On June 25th, 1953. Mm-hmm. That ended July 27, 1953, as armistice was completed. Mm-hmm. During that 3 years of war, both sides, North and South side, compelled to commit to themselves destruction, only destruction. And war, you know, obviously is parts of destruction. Mm-hmm.
Destruction of everything. Each other.
Destroying each other, they're killing mm-hmm. each other. Mm-hmm. And so, started by North Korea, so at the beginning of the war was civil war. But U.S. intervened 4 days later, then intervened until the end of the war. Then when the North Korea was destroyed by Douglas MacArthur, then Chinese intervened. Mm-hmm. It was end of October 1950, yeah. And it became a Sino-American war, essentially. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Became and internationalized.
Uh-huh. Internationalized. Mm-hmm. International war, basically. Mm-hmm. And the war lasted until July 1953. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. But what brought about the war? Like, what made Korea divide and take two sides that wanted to destroy each other?
Well,
even before, you know, the Americans
really
and the Chinese
good,
under
very
communists.
Very good question. When the Korea was liberated, August 15, 1945.
Mm-hmm.
Korea is supposed to be mm-hmm. free, independent, self-governing country. That was promised by Cairo Declaration 1943 by Roosevelt, Chiang Kai-shek, and Churchill. Mm-hmm. But then that has never been fulfilled, although mm-hmm. that was essentially the promise which Allied powers given to the Korean people. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Instead of Korea being united, independent, the Korea was divided, essentially for the military convenience. When Japan surrendered, then the Soviet Union involved, mm-hmm. then the Soviet Union involved, then U.S. involved in the Korean Peninsula, so they want to divide up Korea into two parts, mm-hmm. so northern part be occupied by Soviet Union, the southern part be occupied by United States.
Yeah.
Interestingly, that was proposed by U.S. side, and the person who did it was Colonel Dean Rusk, mm-hmm. later who became a Secretary of State
yes.
under Kennedy.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And he did it essentially to expedite military convenience, it's a military consideration only, mm-hmm. and didn't think about the impact of division on the Korean people.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. He didn't think it would impact the Koreans amongst themselves,
right,
that it would spur on a civil
right,
war amongst
right.
Koreans.
And he didn't think about the consequence of division.
Mm-hmm.
And essentially, division precipitated the Korean War, because North Korea, led by Kim Il-sung, South Korea, led by Sun Man-ri, mm-hmm. want to unify from their point of view.
Yeah,
So Kim Il-sung want to unify from communist, and the Seung Man-ri want to unify from a democratic, free enterprise point
yeah.
of view.
Yeah.
But North Korea had more military strength than South Korea.
Mm-hmm.
So North Korea decided to invade South Korea because they felt that they could actually occupy South Korea within few weeks.
Basically and take it over.
Right, uh-huh. take it over, uh-huh. essentially take it over. And but Kim Il-sung made a mistake, and Kim Il-sung didn't expect the U.S. Would intervene. If Kim Il-sung expected U.S. would intervene, then he would never invade South
yeah,
Korea.
Yeah, probably not.
Right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. would have calculated that that would have been a very risky move,
It's miscalculation.
Yeah. But the U.S. was very concerned because China had already become taken over by the Communist Party that, you know, that defeated Chiang Kai-shek and his Kuomintang forces.
Right,
so this was something that was just beginning to to color the U.S., I guess, geostrategic thinking.
Right. So, you know, as you said, China was taken over by Mao Zedong and finished the occupation of all the mainland as of October 1949. And after that, that essentially, very good point, because that essentially helped Kim Il-sung to make up his mind, because he felt that Mao unified China, and why not him to unify Korea, just as Mao did in the mainland China. So actually, essentially, that helped him to engage in this all-out attack on South Korea.
And neither side was successful, in part because of the intervention of the U.S. in the South, Chinese in the North. So, so, I mean, the aftermath of this is that we still have, I mean, today, you know, North Korea is prominent in American news because we Americans don't have direct relations with North Korea, still close to South Korea, and collaborates quite closely militarily and otherwise. But yeah, the situation there is kind of, you know, left hanging, so to speak, since the war. So,
Well, that is a very good point, because when the Korean War ended in July 1953, essentially, it was armistice, which means ceasefire.
Yes.
The ceasefire still continues, more or less, and there has never been peace treaty between North and South, between North Korea and United States, partly because the United States refused to recognize North Korea. And North Korea resent that. And North Korea's provocations, developing all these nuclear weapons, everything, essentially because they felt they've been ignored. They've been, you know, primarily punished unnecessarily because of whatever reason, you know, U.S. has had and whatever the other countries has had. The other countries probably, some countries essentially recognize, Great Britain recognize North Korea has diplomatic relations, but U.S. never recognized North Korea. So peace treaties never been made. Essentially, that causes one of the major problems, North Korea-South Korea tensions, North Korea-U.S. tensions and all that. Then how come U.S. did not recognize North Korea? Because U.S. feel that the North Korea doesn't deserve recognition because U.S., well, I mean, North Korea has been developing nuclear weapon. But this is basically, you know, the issue of which comes first, peace treaty, reconciliation, or confrontation continue to be.
So we still have a non-concluded conflict, essentially.
That's correct.
Great. Well, let's come back after this break and continue with this conversation.
Okay,
you're watching Global Connections with Grace Cheng here with Dr. Seung-Kyun Ko.
Hello, I'm Michael North, inviting you to join us on The Art of Thinking Smart every second Thursday at 12 noon, here at the beautiful ThinkTech Studios in downtown Honolulu. I'm guest hosting for David Chang of Wealthbridge. Now, we're talking to Hawaii's most intelligent, accomplished leaders about what makes them successful in their professional lives. By absorbing their practical wisdom, all of us can think ahead, think deeper, and become more successful ourselves. We look forward to seeing you on The Art of Thinking Smart.
Hi, this is Jane Sugimura. I'm the co-host for Condo Insider, and we're on ThinkTech Hawaii every Thursday at 3 o'clock, and we're here to talk about condominium living and issues that affect condominium residents and owners, and I hope you'll join us every week on Thursday. Aloha!
Hello, welcome back to Global Connections. I'm your host, Grace Cheng, here with Dr. Seung-Kyun Ko of Hawaii Pacific University. And we're speaking about his book project on the Korean War, as well as its significance today. So welcome back to the program, Dr. Ko.
Thank you.
So let's get into the heart of what your book project is about, because we were talking before the break about the international dimensions of it, the Cold War dimensions. But I understand your book is really about the war itself,
right.
How it was conducted.
Right.
So let's get into that a little bit.
Well, the book is composed of a number of chapters, but the difference between my book and other books are that I included my own experience in the book. So I was in Korea during the war. I was 13 years old. And although I was young, but I was very concerned with the war itself, so I tried to find it out as much as I can. So I had all kinds of experience with war. Actually, when the North Korean troops moved in to Seoul, Korea, on the June 28th, 1950, and as a young boy, I went out to the street and tried to look at what the North Korean soldiers look like. And they marched in, and the tank was right in the middle of the street, the T-34 tanks. And they really look like soldiers.
Okay,
And compared to soldiers I've seen before the war, the South Korean soldiers, and compared those to models of soldiers, North Korean soldiers, really look like soldiers.
Very professional.
Disciplined, professional. So they moved into marching into Seoul, and I look at them. They seem to be completely indifferent to citizens come out to see them. I was surprised that, you know, I felt they may be hostile, but I didn't see any hostility. They're just simply not interested in the people watching them. And some of them smile, but not too many. And citizens who came to look at the North Korean soldiers, they were kind of curious, and they had high degree of suspicion, what would North Korean soldiers would do? So all this kind of observations I include in my book. Then when the Chinese soldiers intervened in end of October 1950, the Chinese soldiers simply pushed the United Nations forces into Seoul, then you know, further south. But Chinese soldiers moved in Seoul on January 3rd, 1951. I stayed in my home until January 2nd, 1951. Then when I heard the communist soldiers outskirts of Seoul, then I moved out from Seoul. Then crossed the Han River. Then walked from Seoul to Daegu, which is about 150, over 150 miles distance. So during that time, I saw the battles someplace. I saw United Nations forces. I saw South Korean soldiers and the American soldiers. And that experience is written in my book.
So as far as like the soldiers that you witnessed coming into Seoul from North Korea, as well, like the Chinese soldiers you were mentioning, are they coming in? What's their purpose? Are they trying to conquer, occupy, remove the government, over institutions?
Right.
You're able to observe them. Seemingly, it seems like, you know, very directly in everyday street life. So what were they there for?
Good question.
What was the purpose?
Well, Kim Il-sung wanted to unify the country under the theme of national liberation. So soldiers move in and want to occupy and want to move down all the way to the south. So essentially, soldiers trying to occupy entire South Korea, then incorporate South Korea into North Korea.
Okay, so they did want to essentially take over, occupy it.
So just like Mao Zedong took over entire mainland China. So essentially that was Kim Il-sung's objective.
And so when you left Seoul, it was after the Chinese also had moved in. There was a UN force in Korea in order to observe, observation.
Well, United Nations forces led by United States forces, I mean, essentially United Nations forces, but led by United States armed forces. And so they actually went all the way to Pyongyang and near to Sino-Korean border after MacArthur was successfully landed in Incheon September 15, 1950. But Chinese intervention forced them to retreat all the way to the 30th parallel, then to the Seoul, then further down. Mm-hmm. So that's when I left Seoul, January 2nd, 1951.
Yeah.
Then walked from Seoul to Daegu.
Understandable, then, huh? Very right. uncertain situation
right.
then.
Right,
yeah.
Right. So okay. That was really interesting because that's the war time, and I saw the battles mm-hmm. and all that. So that part is written in my book.
Okay.
Uh-huh. And that, you know, essentially what happened is I almost killed several times during the course of this marching down to the Seoul. I mean, one instant was mm-hmm. when I arrived in Okchon. Okchon is just a few miles from Daejeon. Daejeon mm-hmm. is a major city in the middle of Korean Peninsula. What happened is at the time a train arrived, and riding a train was exceptionally part of something everybody wanted because, you know, train was not available and mm-hmm. just run every once in a while. But train arrived there. And then about 20 young men came down from the train and they stayed the same place where I stayed, and they were officers' candidates.
Uh-huh.
And then the train was supposed to leave for the next day, 5 a.m. So they told me they could take me with them. So I said, oh, that was really wonderful, because I don't
wow.
have to walk.
Uh-huh.
You know, all this, you know, snow and uh-huh. Cold weather and everything.
Oh, snow, okay, yeah.
So, yes, mm-hmm. so I felt that that was great. So the next day, they tried to wake him up, but I couldn't get up. So I told them, why didn't you guys leave? So they left. And then I went back to sleep. Only about 10 minutes later, tremendous explosion occurred.
Oh, wow.
And what happened is northern guerrillas came down Okchon through the mountain and then put the mines mm-hmm. on the railway track. And that actually exploded.
Wow.
And train was just completely destroyed
oh,
and everything.
My goodness.
And I didn't see, you know, this office's candidates being killed or anything, but
yeah.
assumed they'd be dead because
mm-hmm,
nobody came
right.
back to the city
oh
where I was
God.
Staying at the time. So if I rode that train, then mm-hmm. I was killed, no mm-hmm. question about that.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, so there were real direct effects. Anybody could have gotten caught in and,
sure.
and seriously injured, if not
right.
killed.
I mean,
really
essentially, you know, it's just
uh-huh.
tremendous explosion. Lasted
mm-hmm.
about 30 minutes, it lasted, mm-hmm. you know, continuously.
Mm-hmm.
And so basically, that when that happened, then we couldn't go down because guerrillas saturated around that area. So we just hide wherever we could find the place
uh-huh.
to hide.
Are these Chinese communist guerrillas or,
yeah, I mean, these
or
North Korean
guerrillas?
Guerrillas?
North
Korean guerrillas.
Oh,
good
okay.
question.
Yeah.
They,
uh-huh.
because the guerrillas came down through a mountain.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So they're trying
then
to invade through
the
natural
mountain
landscape.
And sabotage. Objective mm-hmm. guerrillas were essentially sabotage
mm-hmm.
and assassination mm-hmm. and, you know, mm-hmm. trying to destroy mm-hmm. whatever they could find, uh-huh. like railway tracks and all that.
So they use all means of warfare,
means of war.
Not just
yeah.
conventional with
right.
the uniformed
right,
right. professionals.
Right.
So I mean, we're talking about today why, you know, the Korean War. Now it's over 60 years now, right? Why it still has significance? I mean, we talked about, you know, it's a conflict that technically hasn't been concluded,
mm-hmm.
but, you know, you talking about the actual domestic experience, like how the Koreans amongst themselves experienced the war. And yeah, so what is the importance of the war today? I mean, it's very interesting, mm-hmm. the history itself, and to know especially about, you know, firsthand experiences and what it was like to
mm-hmm.
confront guerrillas as well as...
You're right. Good question. Number one, the Korean War has never ended, only ceasefire. So, although there is no shooting going on along the demilitarized zone,
mm-hmm.
but still there are tensions. Korea is the most fortified country in the world. North Korea has about 1 million soldiers. South Korea has about over 600,000 soldiers.
Mm-hmm.
For whatever preparation for the combat that may occur because ceasefire, because a ceasefire means any time the war can be broken out. No guarantee for anything. So that's number one. Number two, because of that condition of ceasefire, both North Korea and South Korea has accelerated building up military forces. And because of ceasefire, North Korea, South Korea do not trust each other.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So as of yesterday, there was a joint military exercise, ROK and the U.S. forces mm-hmm. going on. That's going to last for 2 months. So that essentially precipitated the tensions, continued tensions.
Yeah, yeah.
And the North Korea, they want to develop nuclear weapons because mm-hmm. there is no peace treaty.
Mm-hmm.
And the more North Korea trying to develop nuclear weapons, the more South Korea, U.S. responds to whatever way to deter.
Uh-huh. And work more closely together, the U.S. and South Korea.
It seems U.S., South Korea
has... I mean, and that's, it's probably kind of a mutual feed, right? Like if the North Koreans see that the U.S. is in South Korea, supporting South Korea, then they feel anxious about that relationship. But then they build up their weapons or attempt to, mm-hmm. and then, you know, the other thing happens the other way around.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And secondly, because of Korean War, mm-hmm. not only North Korea, South Korea do not trust each other, but also North Korea has not been able to accommodate themselves into type of government structure to benefit people. Mm-hmm. Essentially, North Korea is the oppressed people mm-hmm. because of this ceasefire issue. So they spend most of their money for military buildup, not for the people themselves.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And South Korea also spend one of the highest spending per capita, and from a mm-hmm. Percentage from GNP compared to other countries.
On their military.
So they. On the military. Mm-hmm. So both North Korea and South Korea waste a lot of money mm-hmm. for military buildup.
Right, right. And I mean, are there reasons still to believe that North Korea will invade South Korea if the U.S. forces are not there? Have there been any chances to work out the differences
good
between
question.
The two sides of Korea?
Right, good question. Right now, there are about 23,000 U.S. forces in Korea, which is a very small number. It used to be, U.S. forces used to be during the Korean War, so over 350,000.
Mm-hmm.
But most of them withdrawn, and only a small number of U.S. forces left over there.
Mm-hmm.
So actually, they don't play that much important role in terms of combat. They're, mm-hmm. they're a symbolic.
I see.
Mm-hmm. U.S. commitment to South Korea's defense.
Mm-hmm.
That's what essentially what it meant to be.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So do you think, like, what are the prospects in the near future for what will happen in the Korean Peninsula? If you could sum that up for us in about a few seconds.
Well, hopefully, U.S. and North Korea would reconcile each other, have some kind of peace treaty, and then that would help to reduce tensions. After that, North Korea, South Korea reconcile each other, either for unification or to exist based on peaceful coexistence.
Mm-hmm.
That would help tremendously to reduce tensions in Korean Peninsula.
Well, thank you. Thank you so much for bringing your experience and your many years of research and observation of this issue going on in the Korean Peninsula. So welcome you back some other time, Dr. Ko.
Sure.
Thanks for your remarks
sure.
today. All right.
It's
so,
my pleasure.
Great, great. And you've been watching Global Connections with Grace Cheng and Dr. Seung-Kyun Ko of Hawaii Pacific University. See you next time, Thursdays at 1 p.m. Aloha.